Okay, we are 5 minutes past, so I think let's get started. Quick question, how many of you attended the last talk that I gave on JavaScript engines and hated the template? Sorry, you'll have to live with it. I mean, it's about JS Foo and had that samurai ninja kind of a feel. So I thought, let me just copy that and copy that for this talk also. So yes, this is a talk on IndexedDB. Let me ask the question again because we have a lot more people. How many of you have used IndexedDB? Heard about IndexedDB? Good. That's a good number. So I don't think I have to go through the basics. You must have seen that this is an intermediate level talk, so I will just be doing a refresher on basics. So how many of you here have seen Star Wars? Star Wars 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, that's a good number. Okay. You know, when I tried to design a theme for this, though I knew it had to be some ninja samurai kind of a thing, I could not get Star Wars out of my mind. So I said, fine, I just do Star Wars. So I also know that I'm the guy who's keeping you from lunch. So bear with me. I'll try to make this topic as interesting as possible. Shout me down if you think I'm getting boring at some time. So yeah, apart from knowing me as the guy keeping you from lunch, my name is Parshuram. I'm a senior program manager at a company that also develops browsers, and I've worked on the IndexedDB specification a little bit. So here goes the story. Long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away, there was IndexedDB. You know, funny that it's actually a galaxy far, far away because a lot of people here are not able to use IndexedDB, right? So that's still a far galaxy far away. And I also tried putting that Star Wars kind of text. You don't have to read this. I put this text up to tell you the kind of applications that you would use IndexedDB for. IndexedDB is effectively a database in your browser. All of you till now have been having databases on the server where you store stuff. IndexedDB is just bringing all the data on your browser so that your apps can be one, intermittently connected like mail or calendar, or like last talk where Pratik gave where his bug databases can be on the server, on the client rather. Secondly, completely offline applications like say, word processors and things like that, which you don't really need to connect to the server. And finally, you can also use IndexedDB to save bandwidth. So rather than keeping the user preferences on your server for privacy concerns and all, you can just leave it on their browser. So that's IndexedDB. So quick IndexedDB refresher. What is this? Have you guys worked with it, used it? Louder. It's a browser. Okay, it's a browser wireframe. Let me put it that way. Because I know a lot of people would say it doesn't look like a browser, but it's a browser wireframe. So on a browser wireframe, you would load a page in that white area, right? That's the domain of the web page. So what does IndexedDB do is, as I told you, it's a database inside your browser. It's like I'm trying to pictorially represent the terms database inside the browser, but that's what it is. And what can be there inside a database? There can be tables, right? How many of you here have actually used databases? Oh, good. How many of you here are DBAs, database administrators? 1, 2, 3, 4. You can count them. How many of you here are front-end developers? And the rest are back-end developers? Okay. You know, yeah, you do both too. That's true. Or some do neither. That's the other part. So the thing is, I've actually seen a lot of front-end developers or developers in general looking at DBAs like as if they are those guardians of data with like those titanic shields and those spears and all sitting and guarding data, right? So here's your time, developers, to play with databases because it's right there in your browser. So as I said, database has tables, but in case of IndexedDB, it's not a relational database like most of you know. So IndexedDB does not have tables. It has a concept called object stores. An object store saves objects. An object is basically a key and a value. So things like one code, x code, so it's a JavaScript object basically. So object store is this, and on the object store, you can have indexes. What is the use of an index in a traditional database? Saves time. What is the use of an index in index database? What is it? It's the same. They didn't want to play around with the terms, so it's pretty much the same. No, this is not Memcache. To put it plainly, it's effectively a database inside your browser. It's a real database. So in Chrome, it's like, it's in Chrome, it's LevelDB. It was SQLite. In Firefox, it's SQLite. In Internet Explorer, it's ESE. So it's actually a database, a living, breathing database. Local storage, you can't do things like iteration. So I'll come to that. But basically, this is a real database. Local database, local storage is a fake database. It tries to. Let me get to that. So effectively, you are a victim of the local storage propaganda. People have fooled you into believing that local storage is a real database. No, it's not. Yes, I will also come to that. So the content of my talk is, this is going to be just the preliminary. I'm just going to talk about this. But I'd be trying to fit on the fact of why IndexedDB came into existence, what existed before it. I'll probably be trying to tell you a story. So let me just quickly get through that Star Wars kind of that initial yellow text that you see, right? Let's just get past it and let's see some action. So you have indexes. You also have this concept of cursors. A cursor is basically an iterator. And you can iterate on cursors also. On a single web page, you can have multiple databases. And yeah, this is just some more Star Wars-like text where you have the concept of transactions like you have in regular databases. And the database APIs are in two flavors. It can be asynchronous or synchronous. This is all you need to know about IndexedDB for this talk. There was a question. So, yep, here starts the story. In the days of the good old Republic, people actually used to use cookies for storage. You know, the problem with cookies is you can't iterate over it. You can't query over it. I mean, you literally can't do anything that you can do with a real database. And yes, you had the cookie monster where you had only so much space that you can use. And there comes your question about local storage. Local storage is not iteratable, first thing. Secondly, it's not synchronous. It's synchronous. It's not asynchronous. So the moment you start storing tons of data inside your database, it's going to take up time, right? True, but is an object enough? You will not be able to iterate over it. You will not be able to select it based on indexes. No, so for example, you have an employee database, and you want to start, you basically want to have an index on names because you want to make all of them stand in a line alphabetically, probably on a fire drill or probably it's more than a key value pair, it's a real database. So database is not about just putting stuff in, it's about being able to do a little more than that. Well, that's actually changing with the structured cloning algorithm that people are going to implement for. Okay, makes sense. So, yes. No, in fact, even IndexedDB has size constraints. So, that's dependent on the browser. The size content isn't as much. That's the point. So yes, cookies and cookie monsters. So that was the days of the old Republic, and then came some Jedi to restore balance in the force. You basically had Google Gears, and that's the story about WebSQL database. So Google Gears was effectively a summer of code project in Google, and amongst other things like web workers and stuff, they also had databases. So Google Gears is like this collection of things that web browsers should just have, but they don't. Things like background threading, or things like SQL databases, stuff like that. One of the earliest indications of databases was the database module of the Google Gears, first released in 2007. And effectively, they started using SQLite kind of a structure. The reason, it was summer of code. People wanted to get something quick and running. What they did was, Chrome was anyway using SQLite for storing bookmarks and stuff. They just exposed the API outside. And that's why Google Gears was the WebSQL database module. What people did was they thought, okay, Google Gears is specific to Google. They started calling it Gears when it was open source. And then they tried to make it a standard and called it the Web Database API, which was then renamed to the WebSQL database. So it is a dialect of SQLite 3. Unfortunately, SQLite 3 is not a standard. And a lot of browser vendors do not accept the fact that a standard should be based on a product. It should be the other way around. So the Web Database API as of today is frozen. By the way, those two references are actually chats. I was not able to find, so I had this in my chat history. I was not able to find email references. This was one of the W3C committee chats where you have these IRC chats, right? It's one of those. Yeah. I should have probably read the spec rather than just reading the mailing list. So, yeah. So that was the days of the old republic when a hero came back and saved the day. But then a hero was born. That was Web Simple DB. So there was this gentleman called Nikunj Mehta from Oracle. He'd done a lot of work with Berkeley DB. How many of you have heard of Berkeley DB? What is Berkeley DB? Louder, louder. Okay. Funny, IndexedDB is based on Berkeley DB. That does not mean or does not imply that IndexedDB is sucky. However, the basic idea is that it's an ISAM-based storage. No queries. You just put values in, get it out, have indexes on them, and that's pretty much it. Apart from that, this is where the concepts of things like entity stores or indexes or cursors came in. So if you look at one of the first frozen specs, so I think the spec has like four versions that are out for review. So these guys have this spec list where they keep committing stuff. So there are four marked or tagged specification versions. The first one actually talks about things like entity stores, cursors, and all. You understand what an entity store and a cursor is, right? An object store, a cursor, and index. So that's when they started talking about it. Interestingly, though they wanted to make it asynchronous, most of these APIs were actually synchronous. So if you want to open a database, the code for that was synchronous. If you wanted to open an object store or get an object store, you used to do get entity store of entity store name, and that was synchronous. So I remember there was this gentleman called Jonas Sicking from Mozilla who actually wrote up an email thread to Pablo Castro from Microsoft saying that synchronous calls are actually slow because synchronous calls will effectively block your UI thread, right? Why do we do AJAX asynchronously? Blocking, right? Same story here. So that email thread spawned, there was a good discussion about it, and they tried to move a lot of APIs into the asynchronous version. However, having said that, the async and the sync model were thought of even then. So even in the first draft of the spec, they said that they wanted a synchronous model in the web worker modules. How many of you have heard of web workers? What is a web worker? You spawn a background. It's not technically a thread. Browser vendors may actually fight over it, but it's not a thread. Yeah, it's kind of hard to define what it is because it's an execution context. Yeah, that's a good way to put it. So, fair enough. It's a way to do background processing. So synchronous was supposed to be there in the background, while asynchronous was in the foreground. The interesting thing is, it was in the first spec that they spoke about things like sequences and queues. And they even spoke about things like entity joins, where you can join two indexes. So in a database world, what is a join? Louder, louder. Check out the commonality. Yeah, it's a way of querying stuff. So, in fact, in the first spec, they had spoken about things like entities, joins, sequences, and queues. Sequence is effectively a sequence of values. Queue is effectively the same queue. Is the regular definition of queue where you put in first and then the guy who's in first comes out first. They had all that in the IndexedDB first specification. And then in the IndexedDB spec grew. People noticed that the force was strong with IndexedDB. And interestingly, it was actually implemented by a lot of folks. I've said IE10 there, but you would notice that IE8 had a prototype implementation of IndexedDB. The best thing was, rather than doing haphazard kind of asynchronous calls, these guys started using requests API. So a request is basically just like in while calling AJAX, you do a new XML HTTP request and then dot on success, right? Similarly, you create an object called a request, and on the request you have a success and a failure handle defined. So the request API started coming up then, and the asynchronous API was made a lot more concrete. Very basic operations like even opening the database is still synchronous, but anything after that became truly asynchronous. And importantly, there was a lot of confusion about what kind of objects can you store. Can you say store a window object, or can you say store a window.alert object? There were questions about that. The second and the third version clarified, saying they referred to this other specification called a structured cloning algorithm. The structured cloning algorithm is a simple algorithm that tells you how one JavaScript object is copied, is exactly cloned structurally into another JavaScript object. Yes, it will have to skip function because function will be out of context, right?
Any properties from the prototype as well?
Prototype as in? I'm actually not sure. It could copy the dot prototype property because the dot prototype is a strong reference, right? Things like DOM window, things that cannot be reproduced on the other side. So I haven't read the full structured cloning SCA spec, but the basic idea being, if you are able to copy it, you should be the copy should have exact same structure as the previous one. It shouldn't have any properties missing or it shouldn't have any extra properties and all. That's the basic idea. You know, this is kind of funny this is actually interesting because, you know, when you clone a database, or when you clone a JavaScript object and save it into a database, some other day you're going to retrieve it out of context, right? You're not going to have the same JavaScript context. And that's exactly why you need its SCA. So let's actually play around with IndexedDB a little bit. Or actually, let me just go to the playing around later. Let me show you the latest version where it is actually doing a lot of interesting things. So the young hero shows promise. Microsoft and Mozilla recognize this promise, and they have blessed IndexedDB spec. In fact, Microsoft even went one step ahead and said that it will not implement the WebSQL database spec. I've actually seen Chrome doing both, but looks like they have retired gears. I do not know about Opera. Opera will throw out WebSQL and implement IndexedDB. Okay, so Opera is also going to do IndexedDB. So looks like all the big browser vendors have accepted IndexedDB. And this is where a real concept of a request. So in the previous one, what you saw was, yeah, there were requests. You do it a request.onSuccess blah. But this is when a request object was defined. So they said that there's a meta object called a DB request. And all operations like open a database table or get data, all of them should return a DB request. You know, there's actually a pun with the title and the request here because these requests are very similar to JavaScript promises. Anyone heard about JavaScript promises? How many of you have used JavaScript promises? Not many. A JavaScript promise is effectively a cooler way of doing, or in fact a better way of doing, asynchronous programming. If you've used jQuery, the latest versions of jQuery, jQuery have promises. They're called deferreds, right? Deferreds. Await is a part, so that's a part of ECMAScript 5, where you have yield and await. So the await is exactly, or is very similar to the C# await. So this was also the first time when the authors thought or spoke about security. I mean, for all you know, you're storing user data in the browser. What are you going to do about security, right? So the idea about security is only the user so the way it is implemented in Windows is, IndexedDB is stored in the location of your username. So any other user cannot access that. However, they also went a step ahead and said that if you're sharing browser sessions with other users who do not have a different username, they will be able to read your data. That was a well thought out choice because there's no point in trying to encrypt and all. That's a whole new ball game, right? So they said no to encryption. They said they will defer the access management to the operating system. They also wrote a section about privacy. This was written after this very interesting cookie monster attack where I actually forgot the name of that experiment, where there was an experiment where you go to a web page, they tell you to delete your cookies, and yet they save to persist your private data in other forms like flash cookies or IndexedDB. Ever cookie, yep. It was called Ever cookie. So the privacy section actually came in after Ever cookie. And unfortunately, the ideas of joins, sequences, and queues are missing. That's kind of funny because now you're left with a local storage kind of a thing, right? And the gentleman here who said that, how is local storage different from this? Well, he can now beat his chest and say, yeah, I was not wrong. There's nothing different. Well, yeah, you can just iterate, nothing else. So you still don't have sequences, queues, and all. It probably will come in later. They will definitely not be compatible with this because this is NoSQL. So by now you would have guessed that this doesn't have any SQL, right? Let me show you how the code looks like, and maybe that should explain a little bit. looks like I do not have internet, so it may be harder. Anyway, I can show you here. So for an example, can you read this? You can't, right? Do you want me to increase the font size? No, so this is how IndexedDB typically, this is a classic IndexedDB example. So what you do is you do things like window dot, you do, let me also, no, let me not overdraft. So you have a request object, and to the request object, you do a window dot IndexedDB dot open. So remember I told you that on the DB request object, you define the on success and the on failure handles. So this is how it is done. So once this is opened, once this database is opened, you will be able to see the on success will be called. And what happens in the on success is this. Which one? No, in fact, even the open call is asynchronous. It was synchronous earlier. All calls now have been made asynchronous. So yeah, that's funny. When you open it, if it does not exist, it automatically gets created. Yes, there is. Let me actually show you that also. So I thought, because most of you said you have worked with IndexedDB, I thought I didn't have to walk you through IndexedDB code, but let me do it anyway. So the other thing is, I told you that there are transactions, right? So this is how you create a transaction. And you can bind a table or an object. So whenever I say object store, mentally replace it with a table. So you can bind an object store to a transaction, and then you can have an add data request. This is how you add data to an IndexedDB object. So this is exactly how it looks like. Okay. Which one? Yeah, it's a per. It's a. It follows the same cross domain origin policy. Yeah.
So, is
there
any way to share domains?
You just like you would share cookies, you can share this. That's a trick answer. The answer is you'll have to go to the server and come back. There's no other way out. And that's intentional because so effectively, what you could do is you can do a CORS kind of a thing where you can have an iframe. Different messages, pass messages between these two. Don't really have to go to the server all the way. But the guy both the guys who are interested in sharing should know that they're sharing. Yes, the question is there is no easy way to query objects. Any other questions about IndexedDB API itself? There's one question here about. Will it not? It runs in a separate process, at least as far as. A couple of browsers that I have seen, it runs in a separate process. So it's an embedded DB effectively. It's a tiny, really embedded. It's SQLite, it's LevelDB, both of them are tiny databases, right?
Does it keep everything in
memory? No, it actually persists it to file.
Yeah, it persists to
disk,
but does it sort of make sure that it
optimizes the memory utilization? That optimization is deferred to the DB implementation itself. It's what SQLite does, it's what LevelDB does. So it's dependent on those guys, and I think those guys know the best, right? Because if it's a tablet, for example, you want to do it differently. An implementation of a LevelDB on tablet and this may be different, right? So
you
can't flush. You can't flush. That's the basic. If that's the question, you can't flush, you can't close a transaction.
No, not just that. I can't even define how much max memory
it should use. There's a 5 MB storage size,
yes,
but not memory. Not memory. You can't. So it's. It's in the same. So today there's no direct API, but just like geolocation asks you, do you want to share your location? There will be an API like that. So there was a lot of discussion about how to do it and where to do it. True. So that's also there. In fact, there was a very big thread about people who, in fact, even I wrote in one small tiny para in that thread where they were discussing where who should be the guy who should ask for more permission. Should it be deferred to the browser? Should IndexedDB have an API for doing it? Because IndexedDB API itself can access it, right? And the other thing is, what do you define storage as? Will storage mean space of the object store plus space of index, or space of only object store, or space of even the metadata? So that's all hard to define. It's not defined yet. Let's write to the W3C committee on IndexedDB, and I'm sure they'll. So, okay, the guys in action, point of contacts are Jonas Sicking is taking care of it from Firefox. Ben Turner is also from Firefox. Germary Oslo is doing it from Chrome. You can actually join the Chromium HTML5 group. In fact, even yesterday there was a mail thread about one LevelDB issue that they had, and they were actively discussing it. So you could write to them. No, so the LevelDB these guys may have it, right? So there's no API, there's no IndexedDB API that says give me more storage. I'm sure it will come though. just like the location guys have done it, right? Geolock guys have done it. So. It cannot be shared by different browsers. It should not be shared by different browsers because just like your cookies, it's effectively the sharing idea is just like cookies. It should not be shared. Firstly, because those Chrome had SQLite, they are completely two different databases. So in the earlier days when Chrome also was SQLite, you could just copy the database, put it here and use it. Funny part is the way these data is actually persisted. Because if you notice, SQLite is a relational database. This is an object store. So the way it is mapped is also different in different browsers. That's why you cannot store it. Yes, yes, that's pretty much about what LevelDB does, right? So all that is deferred to the actual database. This is just the database API. Any other questions before I can move on? Okay, there's one. The question is, can a database created in one domain be accessed by a database, or can it be accessed by another domain? What should the answer to it be?
No.
Why should it be no?
Cross-domain
issues, security issues. So there you have your answer. Same cross-domain policies. No, so it's the same document or domain story. Effectively, just like AJAX, follows the same cross-domain origin policies. That is deferred to the database implementation. The database may or may not be stored in an encrypted format. You, however, could use not so enough JavaScript encryption routines. Encryption in JavaScript is a bad idea because the maths.random is not really random. So technically, it is not. That's why I said in the previous things, if you notice, I said that encryption is deferred back to the operating system. So access management is deferred to the operating system. In case Firefox uses? Extensions, if they are able to access the IndexedDB API, yes, they will be. I would recommend not using direct SQLite calls because the format may change. You may as well use the page context. So how many of you have written Firefox extensions? Good. Jetpack or the XPA, the older ones? Oh, God. Okay. You guys are great. So you have the page mod modules, right? You could use that in the extensions to access the database through the web context. You can technically read and write files, but if you are doing that, I consider you my hero. So. Yes, in that case, local storage would be good enough. However, you can't iterate, you can't index. So effectively the issue is you'll either get all the keys or you'll get none. Imagine you have 100 records. You just need alphabets. So you are a company CEO, and for one fine day you decided to fire everyone between K and S. You won't do that. You can't do that, right? So it's a sanity check. True. So local storage is good for smaller applications, but. Not necessarily. That's a browser specific. Local storage and versus session storage, for example. So that is today. There is no guarantee in the local storage specification that says things should be in memory. In memory is because it's going to be fast. These browser vendors have done all kinds of things to make it fast. In memory could be one way to do it fast. But nothing prevents you from storing it to the disk. No, nothing prevents the browser vendors from changing the implementation is my point. Hold your thought. So come over to the dark side. Now we have Anakin, IndexedDB, to the level where he has matured. He knows all the Jedi arts. But then shouldn't he go to the dark side? I think he should. So the cookies is not a pun, by the way. So this is where he encounters the Sith Lord. The Sith Lord says, no SQL. You would have guessed it's not SQL, right? Well, really? No, it's not SQL. I'm serious. It's definitely not SQL. Okay, then what should I do for querying? Who asked that question? Here. What should I do for querying? You know what they tell us? Well, you've got cursors and indexes. Okay. That's your next question, right? I can kind of mind read. While doing the Jedi thing, I kind of mind read. So, what about complex joins and still no SQL? Well, yeah, if you want it, you can build something on top of it. The reason being, first thing, SQL is not a standard. So SQL is a standard, but the way it's implemented is hard. So picking up SQL as a standard and agreeing, making every browser vendor to agree on that standard is going to be very hard. So these guys said, we'll give you a basic layer. You build your querying capabilities on top of it. That's the basic point. So yes, so that's what they said. And well, I said, okay, fine, let me build something, and that's what I have built. So the Dark Lord says, show me that voice, scary voice. And yeah, I will show you. So what is that? Other side? Spaceship, come on. You can do better. What is that? Millennium Falcon. That's the spaceship by Han Solo for diehard Star Wars fan. I'm one. So this is actually what Obi-Wan Kenobi says to says when he sees the spaceship first, but don't worry about it. That's not related to IndexedDB. So what I did was I picked up the IndexedDB API and wrote a simple link wrapper on top of it. How many C-sharp developers have heard of LINQ? The others are going to kill me, right? LINQ. Okay. For people who do not know what link is, it actually sounds like English. So it's something like, from table in database, select something, when something, condition, or order by something. So this is how link looks like. Okay, I know what you're looking at next. You'll ask me this, right? Fine, I'm just kidding. This was an example that I wrote. I wanted to play around with the IndexedDB API, so I wrote this. However, if you want to write a SQL wrapper on top of it, I'd love to partner with you and write that. The first problem that we'll probably have to solve is see how we can make the SQL compatible with everyone. So let me show you what this looks like. And I'll also tell you why I wrote this in the first place. So this is not readable, right? So this is how my link API looks like. What it does is, let me also do word wrap. It says link dot, link is my workspace. It says to this database, or to this object store in this database, add the data. And once you've added, then promise console.info or console.error. So tell me, what is this doing? What does this do? To an object store in a database, add data. What does it do? It saves data, right? Is link that complex? So effectively, it tries to save data. So this is the syntax that I came up with to save data, and that mimics link. The reason I'm showing you this is, if you didn't write this, you would probably end up writing this. You'll probably end up writing so much of code. So what I wrote was, I was writing IndexedDB applications, and I thought that writing so much of code every time is kind of crazy. So I thought, let me write an API on top of it, and I came up with the link API. So I also have stuff like this. Let me do this. From object store, order by price, and order by price reversed, and for each print. So this is what it looks like. It says from database in bookshop, order by price, one is like 0 or 1, where 1 is reversed. Select everything, and for each of them, do a console.info. If you were not to do this, you would effectively end up writing this much of code. So this is one thing, one simple example I wrote, saying that, okay, this is a simple querying service that I can give you on top. So here you can have stuff like, where property equals. You can do stuff like this. So this is a library that I wrote that gives you simple querying capabilities. Moving on. So by the way, if you're actually considering IndexedDB APIs, you could try this out if you're a fan of link. If you are not, probably God help you, but let me actually move on. So you saw this, but I know what you're telling me. Link is not my cup of tea. It's hard, right? How about jQuery? So I kind of thought, yeah, fine, I'm also a jQuery guy. Let me try to write the same link kind of a syntax on jQuery. So I wrote an IndexedDB API on jQuery. Oops, why did I go back? Yeah. So I wrote a simple jQuery plugin for IndexedDB, and let me show you how that looks like. Why has it not loaded? Yep. So for example, if you, let me just minimize my browser. Yeah, for example, if you want to create an object store, you do something like this. You say $.indexDB.createObjectStore. If you want to say add data, let's look at the same add data example. I create a window.book object and I populate it with some random data. And I do stuff like index in this database, in this object store, add this book. Instead of this, if you were to follow the IndexDB way of doing things, you would probably have to write so much code. So it's a simple jQuery library that I wrote to simplify the way you're working with IndexDB. I'll be having links for both of these libraries at the end of my talk, and if you're using IndexDB, which you probably are not going to in the near future, but if you plan to play around with IndexDB, you could try give a shot to these libraries that I have written. This is actually production ready. I have a couple of my personal projects on IndexDB today is not ready. It's definitely not ready because major browsers don't support it yet. You will have support with like IE10, Firefox 5, so Firefox 5 plus, Chrome 12 plus. That's kind of not. You don't have support in Opera. Simple, right? So that it's not production ready, but once it gets there, I hope this library helps people. So coming back to my presentation, I know what you're asking me now. Someone defined the IndexDB library, and I don't have faith in them. And I've written wrappers on top of it, right? You know the reason I wrote it? First thing is this: there is no joins. Do you think you need joins in IndexDB? How many think you need joins? Just 1, 2, 3, 4. Good. So we could maybe. So I tried writing that in Link. Probably we could do it in SQL. But I think we definitely need joins. They suggested doing union and intersection in JavaScript. Well, you can do union of two arrays, object arrays. That's okay. But once it starts increasing, your code is going to get bad. There is no full text search, if you notice. By the way, this is also a proposal. Who do you think, or which company do you think proposed or asked for full text search in IndexDB? Oracle. Oh, who else? Yeah. So they effectively wanted to search the IndexDB, right? I mean, when you put data, don't you want to search? Unfortunately, there's no full text search, and there's a technical reason to it. The way Microsoft IndexDB is implemented is possibly completely different from the way SQLite is. And probably SQLite could give you IndexDB search capability. But say Google's V8, Google's LevelDB could not, right? So it's a database-specific feature that was asked for. It was not taken. Probably in the next version. There's no capability to roll back your database, right? I mean, all the DBAs love the idea that you go mess up with a client database and then roll it back quietly as if nothing happened. Have you done it on production systems? Deploy something, roll back? Well, I have done it. Oh yeah, of course everyone has done it. So there's no DB rollback. So today if you do this, you're pretty much on your own. There are versions supported. So if you change the database schema, you can do a set version. I didn't show you the calls, but I thought everyone here knew IndexDB. So versions are supported, but not fully. And there was one question about syncing with the server, right? Who was that? You wanted to sync with your mothership. Yeah. So the question was, I have a database on my client, and I want to sync it to a SQL server or a MySQL at the server. How do I do it? You will have to write code today. It's actually even worse because there's no change tracking mechanism. So if something changes, if you have 10 tabs, and if something changes in one tab, or if you have like 10 applications on the same domain, and if one of them changes it, you'll have to write custom logic so that everyone else listens. There's no change tracking API. So, which effectively means that writing a sync to the server is a very hard thing to do today.
It has transactions. Does it have
different isolation levels? It has isolation level, but change tracking is different, right? So imagine that. 4 or 5 people have written it, and so on the same domain, you have 3 applications coming. The first 2 applications have a contract saying that if I change something, I'll send you a message. The third guy doesn't know about this contract. It's kind of hard, right?
That's right. So my question is then, if it has isolation levels, I can
read and commit to it and stuff like that? True. So it has a read, write transaction level, but transaction levels are not equal to syncing with the server, right? Because you want to sync whenever something is changed, and that will not be possible with this. So you would need possibly a row-level syncing where you say, this row has changed, so send it to the server. Or this row has changed, and hence raise an event for me. And I could possibly listen in that event and change it, right? Doesn't have that.
There is no observer
Yes, unfortunately, there's nothing like that. And by the way, I said USS Enterprise, no one noticed. How many Star Trek fans here? Good. I said USS Enterprise in the Star Wars convention, but yeah, sorry. I'll just strike it out. And the future is always in motion. All this is good. If you notice one thing, IndexedDB does not do anything that's related to DOM. It's all JavaScript, right? How does ECMA change it? First thing is, IndexedDB may become a module. IndexedDB, rather than using requests, DB requests, they can actually fall back on promises, which is anyway part of JavaScript. We could actually have iterators and generators instead of cursors, right? That's a good idea to have. It would be able to save binary blobs, which is important. Today, it cannot. But with WebGL, it may be required to save binary blobs. And things like destructuring assignments will be useful. So whenever you read an object, you simply destructure it, and you can read the entire object back. So this may be useful when ECMA 5 comes in. And classes may actually be construed as a way of object schema. Today, there's nothing called object schema in IndexedDB. Classes could be that. So with this, I leave you. May the force be with you. And this is me. Questions? The implementation across Firefox, so the latest implementation is actually pretty consistent. It is pretty consistent. It is pretty consistent. So spec is in its editor's draft. Last call for comments, I guess. You never should believe when these guys say it's going to be done by end of this year, but that's what they've said.